Yeah, that's where they can put in the agenda as well as the transparency which Vikas was talking about. It is a recommendation made by the quota committee to the government that we should incorporate.
It is now part of the listing regulations. Yes, it is responsibility of the board to have
once in a year you have to discuss succession
planning. And moreover, two of the strong pillars of corporate governance are independent directors and performance evaluation. Performance evaluation of the board, of the directors, of the committees. The day we have independent directors, absolutely independent, and the day we have this performance evaluation, absolutely transparent, I tell you, we will have best of the succession planning also.
On data, sorry, there's a question. I thought there's nobody's asking a question, so I thought I'll fill in.
Yeah, please.
Good afternoon, all. Sir, we have been talking about the different business groups and their succession planning. So I just wanted to ask about the Godrej Group. Is it an example of perfect succession planning, or in Indian context, we can take any other business group if you want to quote any example?
I'll take that question because I know the fact. Whether it's a perfect succession planning or not, we will possibly know by the next decade. Because their daughter just took over, the son has resigned, taken a smaller role. This happened only in the last week. And they're now grooming in the daughter or the granddaughter, I'm not sure of the generation, to take over. So whether it's successful or not, we will know only, time will tell. Whether they have enough thought has gone into that is being done or not, that we actually do not know. It's not in the public domain. And that is where, once that is implemented from this year, the agenda of succession planning coming up in the board and becomes part of the minuted meetings of the board, published as part of annual returns, it's only then we will be able to start, we'll start assessing of how the succession planning itself is being done. Good, bad is very difficult. So I really don't know. I don't think we can really take a call whether it's good or bad, but this has just happened. And on the face of it, it looks like an abrupt decision. That's just my personal thing, because it suddenly come out of the blue. For last 7 years, 5 to 7 years, they were grooming this gentleman to take over after Adi. And then now, suddenly, last week, this news comes in. So to a layman who's not part of the group, it looks like an abrupt decision to replace one family member with the other. Questionable from that perspective, but possibly they would have thought over it, discussed it, and then taken that decision. Let's not take it away from them. They might have done it there.
One of the best examples of the crisis succession without any planning is in the case of Aditya Vikram Birla. He died in a plane accident and then his son took over.
Ashok.
But in case of Kumar Mangalam Birla, all of a sudden...
No, but then he was being trained. That I know personally, because, dear friends, Aditya Vikram knew that his time is running short, because he had diagnosed with malignancy. But Ashok Birla died in an air crash.
That's okay, but Kumar Mangalam Birla also didn't have much of time.
He got it in his late 20s, when he was 28.
And after that, he has not looked back. The group has expanded like anything.
So let me give his example to take it forward. When this was put as a question to Kumar Mangalam Birla, that whether he would want his children to take over, he, unlike most others, is open about it, and he says, yes, I would like them to. And so he said, wouldn't they be lesser qualified than other professionals who are studying everywhere? So his answer was that please do not underestimate what these children learn at the dining table with me, with my experience. He went on record to say that. And which is to be taken note of, because educational sources are many. Institutions are one. Actual business people are another. And this somehow has some sort of validation from 2017's report published by Credit Suisse, which says the return on equity, which is given by business, family-run businesses, have far outnumbered return on equity by professionally managed companies. They published this report in 2017. They analyzed over 900 family-owned businesses and non-family-owned businesses across the world. And even in terms of, and the difference was not marginal, it was large, 400 basis points, which is 4%. It's huge. 4% is the return if you invest internationally, this is more than the return you're going to get on your capital invested. That's the difference.
There's nothing wrong in dynasty rule also. Even
so,
even in politics, they also learn politics on dining
table. The reasons they're still studying about it, that it's because of the inherent understanding which the next generation gets while growing up on that technology. Not to take away from it, the part of the reason is not that the families are better. Part of the thing is that professional inroads into businesses is not yet so large as it should be. As we are going forward, it's becoming more and more professionally oriented because the business is becoming large. It's not feasible for a single person to control. I think we're going there.
It, as correctly said by Vikas, the most important question is again the same. It is although a very, very debatable question at what level the founder should control once they have retired from their managing directorship or chairman, at what control, at what level they should step in into the business, or should they put in whatever succession planning they have, they should give them an independent time to run the company. It's again a very, very debatable question, although there's no perfect answer to the same, either in the positive way or negative way. Succession planning done by the businessman has its own advantage, disadvantage, depending upon the circumstances. We have narrated at different case studies. Few were successful, few business houses were unsuccessful. But at the same time, we have to realize now it's a time for the businessman, business houses to realize it cannot be a rule. What can be a thumb rule? Ki my eldest son or my eldest daughter will become the managing director. We have to realize whether he or she has a capacity to run the business. Same is being going into the politics right now. As you are aware, there are two different political parties. And one political leader who is a honorable prime minister of this country and another party, I think, is facing the succession problem is Indian National Congress right away. So is Rahul Gandhi's succession a real example, or it can be, is it a right planning done by the party or not? So it depends on the circumstances. So
again, we don't know whether it's successful or not. That time will tell.
Right.
But I believe a lot of thought has gone into it, rightly or wrongly.
So it cannot be questioned that the eldest son or eldest daughter can be just a managing director without making no efforts. It depends upon the individual qualifications, individual thought process. But at the same time, as correctly narrated by Dr. Vikas, as said by Mr. Kumar, the experience also matters a lot. So before we wind up, I would like the final conclusion to be given by first by Mr. Madan on the topic. Is it very really, again, the question is the same because of the positive or negative bit. Is the founder control really necessary in the present business dynamics or not? If yes, at what level? Just to conclude the overall panel discussion, I would like the final conclusion by Mr. Madan.
I think Dr. Harsh is looking at his watch. We need to wind up the session.
Okay,
it's only half a minute only. Yes, we do need founder's control. There is nothing wrong in the founder's control. Founder control with perfect professional management and best of the succession planning is a must for every business.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am, your final view.
In my view, founders has experience and the young generation has energy. We should match up that energy with experience to grow the business.
Well said, ma'am. Dr. Vikas, your view.
The debate that Varnit was pointed out, if you want to read up on that, you just Google founder's dilemma. That's academically the word they used it, and you'll find a lot of material on what both sides goes in, what's the philosophy behind it, and how different businesses have adapted to it and done it. Any business, as I said, your succession will start with founder's control. So your key documents, if you are a business entity, then your shareholders agreement or the founder's agreement, that will be your constitution. That's going to determine even your succession planning. So be very careful when you're advising or as managers, you're working in a company. That's very important. And at the family level, when you're trying to do it for the wealth of the business, is a family constitution, which everyone should have, not just the will. We've now crossed the stage where you've gone to the next level. Will is just not enough. You have to have a family constitution if your interests are diversified if your wealth is diversified and if your family is diversified. So I think as managers or as professionals when you graduate or as lawyers when you graduate, I think a tremendous opportunity in India. Suddenly there is a whole lot of demand for people, professionals who will advise on founders control as well as succession planning. It's a huge area of work for you and great opportunity. So even academically, I think you should look at it very carefully.
So as correctly said, Dr. Vikas has given us a new field which the upcoming lawyers need to just do a self-analyzing how this field can be made into a career option. It could be a very important discussion by the businessman. They require a lot of expertise into deciding what should and how should be the succession planning. With I would like to thank you all for listening us patiently. I would like to thank Mr. Madan personally for sharing his expertise, knowledge on the topic. Ma'am Sangeeta ma'am for her legal opinions on the same, and of course Dr. Vikas for sharing us the good live examples of different methodology. And I would like to thank at last the management of Banasthali for hosting this conference. Thank you all.
And thank you, Varnit, for holding us together. Thank you so much.